new kind of VC out there, right? So, Hari leads seed investment at Astarc Ventures. He has 12 years of experience, 6 years of which has been as an entrepreneur in the education space, and he's raised angel investment, he's exited his company to a listed education player. And post that, he spent 3 years with us at Venture Intelligence, helping us spruce up our technology. And in 2014, he returned, or at least he went to the dark side, you know, so for reasons known best to him. So Hari began his career as an IT guy at Putney, currently iGate, and has an integrated master's in management from m.Paani. Hari, can I welcome you on stage? So as you can see his message there, you know, this is going to be as interactive as it gets. So keep WhatsApping him, you know, with questions that you have. He'll try and put them together and, you know, kind of try and get those answered. So we'll keep this as tricky as possible. So his co-panelists, you know, as I welcome them on stage. So we have a small change here. Sachin Jaiswal, co-founder and CEO, niki.ai. Akanksha Hazari, founder and CEO, m.Paani, or should I call it m.Paani? It's m.Paani.
Right, wonderful.
Sachin Jain, co-founder and CEO of Oriano Solar, and G. Ramasubramanian, co-founder of SiriusOne Capital. So all of them have been through the pangs of entrepreneurship. All of them have raised some kind of external funding, and they're going to spill the beans on their investors today. But Sachin already asked me, is my investor in the audience? So I told him as of now, no, so you can start off before he gets here. Thank you so much.
Very good afternoon, all of you. Welcome back after the lunch. So the WhatsApp is to sort of keep us all active post-lunch. Start WhatsApping right away, and we'll try and pick in all interesting questions as time permits, and shoot it to the panelists here. We have a very interesting composition of the panel here. So you have Subbu and myself on both the sides. We've been entrepreneurs, we've been angel investors, we've started deploying our funds from our venture capital firms that we're currently representing as well. So, and you have three entrepreneurs here who are currently running their businesses. One common thread obviously is that all of us here have raised monies, and that's the experience that we are hoping to share with all of you across today. And I hope our panelists will be sort of generous and open up the real life stories, some insights to share with you guys, and what are the learnings that could help you when you go and fundraise for your ventures. Or if you're an investor, you should obviously be aware of those stories as well. Great, so let me start with Akanksha here. So Akanksha, when you started out m.Paani, I understand you started with winning the Hull Challenge prize. There are a lot of stories, maybe you could tell us the real story about it. And that's an interesting way an entrepreneur to start fundraising for a startup. Probably go win a challenge, win some award. Without equity, if you can actually get some money to kickstart your business, that's an interesting, obviously great way. So if you can probably walk us through that and then a couple of questions up.
So first of all, if you want us to spell the names, you shouldn't invite our investors. m.Paani is actually my second company. My first company, I actually bootstrapped and took to profitability in the States over 6 years. And so my foundation, or my kind of what's ingrained in me as an entrepreneur, is that you have to make money. And so this company, my second company now that started in India, it's the first time I've actually raised equity. And so my instinct again when I started m.Paani was like, how do I get money? How do I get free money, or how do I think strategically or hustle to get capital to get the business off the ground? And given that this is a tech company, I believe tech companies have CapEx, and CapEx is our user growth initially and building out our product. And so I needed capital to fund my initial phase of my MVPs and my initial user base, etc. And so because I come from that background from my first venture, I instinctively looked around, and there is money out there, so I looked at competitions. So we won the Hulk prize, which is $1 million prize. We only ended up getting $300,000. It was a bit of a scandal around that, but we got $300,000. and then, because the NGO, Matt Damon's NGO stole the $1 million, so pillar called privately, then funded m.Paani. Then went on to get a couple of fellowships. So there was a long road of capital before I spoke to my first venture capital investor. So I was an Unlimited India fellow that had capital, 80,000 rupees. That 80,000 rupees was still a lot of money when I had no money. I put in some of my personal savings, went on to be an Ashoka fellow, was an echo, literally looked at all the competitions and all the grants. Built an MVP, got a minimal amount of scale, and actually did the first sales and proved revenue on a small scale before I ever walked up to my first venture capitalist. And that's kind of my approach to kind of building a business.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Great, without equity, if you can get some money, I think great way to start. Turning on to Subhu, the entrepreneur investor, so he started his first venture in 1999. It was an IT services firm called E-Brahma that he later sold to CSE. Later on, he started angel investing in other startups. So my question to you, Subhu, how was 1999 when you were running the business? Did you fundraise in that venture? How was that experience, if you can give an introduction, and also what you were creating?
So actually, there are two parts to it. We started off with what was popular at the time, which was the services play. I think somebody mentioned in the morning in the panel that it was essentially a kind of an arbitrage kind of a business. But that was the in thing in those days, in 96 actually, not 99 when we started. It was all hunky-dory till the dot-com thing burst in 2000. So actually, to the point where we had a lot of venture capitalists kind of lining up outside the door, saying that we would like to fund you, because I had just then left the TCS after 13 years, and then with a couple of other colleagues started this company, a pure services play. Right? So at that time, I think the inclination was not to take that capital, primarily for fear of dilution, so we did not take that money at that point in time. So in a sense, looking back, I think it was kind of a misjudgment, because what happened after 2000 was the entire thing went south, and so we had to really repurpose our business, change the business model, give it around to something else before we went around and asked for funding again. That was the lesson at that point in time. So subsequently, we had a product kind of a spin-off from the company that got funded, and then 2006 we exited. So that was the experience all in all. So in a sense, my memory from those days is essentially that when things are good, from a venture capital point of view, you see a lot of guys lining up at the door. But when things start going south, then you have to kind of face the music alone, right? Because that's the kind of impression I had of those days. And there was very little mass at that point in time. There were a few people who were into investing, not like today where you have. But I think that was a big change that I see from those days to what I am doing from the other side as a personal private investor, as well as from an angel fund perspective, that the ecosystem is much stronger today than it was those days. So the options were limited, so you did not have too much of bargaining power when you came to accepting capital. So you pretty much had to go with the flow and take what was offered and on whatever conditions it was. But I think today the situation is very different. So we pretty much are on an equal footing is what I see when I negotiate with entrepreneurs today.
That's interesting. So is the lesson probably, timing of taking the money, need to be probably very conscious about that. And second, should I say, if money is coming to you, probably take it as the best strategy?
Yeah, I think it's about how you are. Do you have a game plan for deployment? Because that is again, I think one of the things which I look at when I invest today. Just throwing money on an entrepreneur when there is not too much of a visibility in terms of deployment and the roadmap and kind of a path to the cash break even, this is not going to help. So you need to kind of measure it out as it goes along, right? That's what I think. So, but from an entrepreneur perspective, maybe it's a good idea to have, I think it's a comforting thing to have a commitment, if not actual cash on the table, which says that, I'm going to fund you maybe not in one tranche, but maybe in two or three tranches. I'm okay with that from an entrepreneur perspective, as long as it is certain and not tied to something else. So that's what I think.
Great. Turning on to Sachin here. So Sachin runs a valley type startup in India, right? It's going to be a very different sort of context, very different probably even in terms of fundraising, one of the very early AI companies that started out in India, to go out and educate the investors probably what is AI and can you build a business around that, etc. So I wanted to understand, so using in India, you went out and raised money from Ratan Tata, Ronnie Screwala, and then later from SAP Ventures. So can you help us understand how you reach out even to these large names, right, initially in the first round? Take us through the journey and a little bit of what you do.
So, I mean, before starting Niki, I actually had an experience running another startup called Innovisive, where we raised money from Lightspeed and a bunch of other investors as well. So I had some experience in raising money, but yeah, I think for something that we were doing, it was kind of a very new venture, and AI back then globally was not something that was sort of sought after, and I think most of the VCs that we went to back then told us that is there a replica in US kind of a thing, right? So, but anyways, I think our journey was very, very simple. So we realized that the stage of the company determines a lot as to what kind of investors we should approach, right? So in the about 3 years ago when we started fundraising, we realized that we were still to prove that the product can work, right? And whether a market for this exists. So we realized that initially it's best to raise a small amount of capital from an angel investor. So we raised the first round from Ronnie Screwala, and then and back then he was not really very very keen on investing in startups, but I think he kind of liked the idea that we were working on and the team that was on it. So he placed the first bet, and then from there on.
How did you approach him? Did you know him, or was it a cold call? Did you get introduced?
No, it was just an email. It was a cold email, I think it was just a lag. So we did reach out to multiple other investors as well back then. We did get a few meetings as well, but then we did at that point in time as well. We did have an offer from a strategic investor, an offer from a smaller angel investor. We had an offer from another sort of a kind of a growth growth stage.
Strategic investor when you were raising the first angel.
First angel, yeah.
Good position to be in.
Yeah. Yeah, but then we eventually rejected it. We went ahead with Ronnie because I think few things that we realized that we would need at least at that stage to build the business was that we wanted more independence in building the product. We wanted more freedom, and I think we wanted to stay neutral as far as we could, right? So so we realized that it's best not to take strategic money so early, and not also not to go raise from financial institutions, VCs, because for them they have a life cycle, and you have to show returns, right? So today the stage is very different. If we go out to raise VC money today, it'll be an attractive proposition for a VC, but back then it was not. Right. So that was the first step, and then after we had raised that money, Ronnie actually introduced us to Mr. Tata, and then he liked what we were doing, so he invested. And then especially for SAP, it was very, very different. So we did not reach them; they reached out to us. We worked with them as part of an accelerator program, and they kind of understood what's the tech that we're building. And gradually, once they had the comfort, they went ahead and invested in us. So yeah, that's
pretty interesting. So let's go to the other Sachin. So I think Sachin is a lucky name to have, right? Like starting from Sachin Bansal's, I should consider.
Yeah, not for that.
Yeah, and probably if as an investor, if there is an email that comes with either Bansal or Sachin, you should probably take a serious look at it,
by the way.
Sachin, so you run a very different company from the rest of the panelists who have some technology element, right? So you run a clean tech company in the solar side, Oriano. So can you talk us about how did you start it, and how was your experience of fundraising? You also fundraised from SIDBI, which is a very different approach. Not too many of us have been able to sort of understand how that process works. If you can probably talk about that as well.
Thanks, Hari. So see, we basically, you know, like we started 2.5 years back, and you know, basically solar energy, you know, comes under infrastructure, and unlike, you know, we will see a lot of venture capital or, you know, in terms of angels or you know, the investment firms are typically interested, you know, in whether it is commerce or software or maybe technology oriented. And solar was, you know, like a pure, you know, like an infrastructure business, and not many of them were really interested. So this was a bit of a challenge for us initially when we started. And basically I started this with my two other co-founders, and you know, one of the reasons was I've been in solar for quite long, and solar pretty much, you know, it's a very capital intensive business, so it's very difficult to start really from scratch. So one was clear that we were looking to raise capital. Second being having a team of co-founders and the existing set of, you know, they were running existing businesses, so that helped. Then in terms of approaching VCs, we literally found it, you know, like most of the investors were not really interested, and like Sachin mentioned, we did send cold emails to I don't know how many, right? And many of them did reply very quickly, okay, and that was very positive, that at least even if it was negative, they were like responding. So but coming back to your second point on SIDBI, so SIDBI has been, you know, like the moment we started, maybe the first month itself we approached SIDBI. This was through a common friend, and he was from the banking side, so he took us to SIDBI. And prior to that, I have been like almost 10 years back, I started my first venture, and we were very close to, you know, again that time working with SIDBI, so SIDBI was very close to us. So this time, so we did start the process with SIDBI, SIDBI Venture Capital, and they were, you know, they were interested in the space, but of course we didn't have anything, no revenues, nothing to show off, right? So anyway, you know, we stayed in touch with them like almost for 1.5 years or so. But almost like 7 to 8 months down the road, we were showing our progress, we were in relationship with them. They could see the progress of the business, and we were also quite comfortable with them as the, you know, like as a venture partner in our business. So as and when, you know, like as we were growing, eventually it was very clear that they wanted to invest. So it almost took maybe 1.5 years for that process. But eventually they came in, and this was difficult again with SIDBI. DFID was the main LP in this. So again, a lot of processes and everything was involved in that. So it took a lot of time. So yeah, that was.
But that was the first round, and it was.
Yeah, that was the first round. Yeah, we did with SIDBI. This was about a 3 million round, and later on, I did. After that, I believe it was much easier. Like we were almost reached out by several venture debts, and quite a few. We even closed with Caspian. Caspian is again backed by OPEC and Trados, and a lot of global LPs are there in that. So we did another round of 1.5 million with Caspian. So, but I think so. The second was more of very easier. You approach them, and like many of them are still willing to give, because first of all the business is doing well. Plus, you have already a lot of due diligence being done by the SIDBIs and the DFIDs of the world. So it has, second round was much easier. It was on the venture debt side though. The SIDBI was more on the equity side. Yeah.
Oh, great. Excellent. So probably the learning from here is, if you're in an atypical business for a VC, which is not technology but early stage, you're just starting out, you know that it's going to take a long time for someone to cut a check, then probably you go to them as early as the first month like you did. Even if it's simply, probably know that they maybe they take a little longer than the other private VCs, but go and approach them early. There's something that has worked out for them. And also to follow up, he's also tapped into venture debt, which is arising as a new form of capital. And we've at least formed 5-6 funds that got formed very recently in the venture debt category. So that's another avenue to tap into for entrepreneurs in the room as well. Great. So there is one question on WhatsApp, which I'm going to read out to the panelists. The question says, it's from Agnes. Agnes, if you can just identify yourself. Thank you for the question. It's from Orders Brands. So how's life as an entrepreneur pre and post funding raised, and what are the pros and cons? Maybe I'll start with Akanksha again, because she said, I wanted to bootstrap my business all the way, not take capital. And then eventually she did, so probably if you can give a view on it.
Before and after raising funding?
Yes, and the pros and cons of raising funding.
The pros of raising funding is that you have funding. You can pay the bills. So the life definitely changes because it becomes a much more structured, target-driven roadmap. And I think that in the early days of being an entrepreneur, a lot of what investors look at as you as a founder or co-founders, and then the team and the people, and then what the vision is and how big the idea is, and they're betting on that kind of those two things together. The further you get along in your funding journey, traction matters. And so one is the environment in which you're operating becomes a lot more structured, and I would consider that a pro in the sense that you know, you start having someone guiding you on how to build a business in a far more structured way, keeping you on a roadmap, pushing you to create roadmaps and goals and targets. And I like working in a structured way, so it lends itself to progress and making sure you're not wasting time. The cons are this, I think you're answerable to a lot more people, and I take personally the responsibility of someone else's capital very seriously. Because also I put in capital myself, and I know it's somebody's money, even if it's not your VC's money, it is an LP's personal money. It's someone's money that's come from work they've put in at some point in time in their life. And I take that very, very, very seriously. And so in that respect, I think as you raise money, I take the responsibility of delivering for a new set of people is something that adds pressure. And as you scale, you're also more responsible to a team of people who are on your payroll. And so I think where I take a lot of pressure as we go further along in the money is that, or further along in the journey, is that I want to make sure that I deliver for the team and that I'm a strong leader and I deliver for whoever's invested and bet on us. And I think the investors earlier in the journey, I value them an incredible amount because a lot of the time they're just betting on you and they're putting faith in you. And for them in particular, the angels and our early round investors, I want to make sure that they are successful because I value the bet that they took on me and the bet that they took on the vision that I have of what we're building.
From the panel, wants to add.
See, in our case, I will take a little bit differently. Though the Sirbi round happened like almost 1.5 years, in formation of the company. When we started, so like I told, we were like, I was working with other of my other co-founders. And for me, at least, that was like, getting a kind of an initial kind of a support system. Right, and so the existing businesses were there, which they were running, so we could use the existing infrastructure plus the teams were there, like if I need HR or admin or finance, everything was already there in existing businesses, right? So for me, coming from a corporate, working for last 15 years, to take a plunge, it was difficult. But having other co-founders who were running the business, so some amount of support system was there, right? So I will say for me, that came as a very significant positive, you know, in terms of my life, you know, changing from, you know, if you are without funding, I can understand, you know, it's like really very difficult. You know, till you get raise the funding round, and you know, you have to pay, of course, other people's salaries plus your own salary as well. So this was quite, I would say, helped a lot, because I could see that there is a stability in the other business which we are doing. Plus also we could use their, you know, working capital lines. So that helped a lot, you know, in terms of, you know, getting and executing our initial orders. So life has changed immediately, I would say, you know, at least some support system was there. Pros and cons, you know, like coming, if you are on the corporate side and if you are coming on the entrepreneur side with funding, of course, you will have a kind of a mental peace that, you know, that of course you don't have to worry more, or, you know, in terms of, you know, where will you pay your bills off, you have to look at more of the growth of the company. So that kind of pros you will see. And in terms of cons, you know, I really don't see this as a con. Only thing is, you know, we have to spend a lot of time with them, you know, in terms of our processes. But in a way, it has helped us a lot, because lot of, you know, it is now helping us, and we are seeing a lot of beneficiaries, you know, in terms of our processes, which has got streamlined, which were not there as a startup. You know, a lot of lot of bills, you know, we are paying to your vendor, so everything is now very much streamlined. So I really don't see that as a con. Maybe immediately you may see, but in the long term, it is helping the company. So yes, I mean, you know, it's a very, you know, I would say, very right question. I mean, you know, I can go on, but I'll stop for now.
Just to add to what the other said, I could relate to it from both sides of the table. As I said, during my entrepreneurial days, if I had an investor who came in with not just money but with other complementary skills or inputs that would have added value to the business, I would really appreciate that. The fact that I missed it became obvious, you know, later or much later down the line, because we did have a lot of gaps in our collective skills in running a business. So that would have really helped. So, when I do investments today, I really look for opportunities to do value addition more than the money that I put on the table for the investment for the entrepreneur. And it really is gratifying, because you know, when they do take it in the right spirit, they really tap into your experience. You know, it gives you a sense of fulfillment, you know, and when you do that kind of you know, value addition. Just to give a couple of examples of companies that I invested in. They just call me, you know, it's a very informal kind of a relationship, you know, he says, hey, I'm interviewing a key person, would you be able to come and sit in the panel? You know, things like that, you know, it is really, really good, because I think that was something that was missing like 15, 20 years ago, which is currently available as inputs from a variety of people who can contribute in a variety of ways.
Yeah, and just one thing that I wanted to add, and I think this is something that I've realized with my journey so far. So one of the major things that you learn as an entrepreneur after funding is that you build some risk appetite, and this is very, very critical for an entrepreneur starting his journey. Right? So if you and it could be it helps you in very, very small micro decisions. For example, there's a new feature that I should build, and this could lead to better retention. Right? If you don't have the capital, you don't have that kind of a luxury to sort of build that particular feature. Because you're in a recurring cycle wherein you continue to operate with the cash flow that you have, and you don't have additional capital to you know, add that particular feature that may not make your product more viable. You could take decisions like hire more salespeople so that you can increase the you know, the revenue that you earn. You can spend more on marketing and so on and so forth. So these are some of the decisions that I think becomes easier once you have growth capital with you. And yeah, I think that is one of the major impact that I see when I mean post PA's funding.
So
Sachin,
I think you just to add to that, I
you have more stakeholders and you're vested in your success. So the second round or the subsequent rounds tend to be easier, at least in terms of speaking to people, than your very first round, because there are more people pushing you forward. But I do think the downside, no, the downside or the risk is you have to make sure you have the right investors and the right money. Because if you are not aligned with your investors, or you do not share the same value, or you do not have the same vision, then the cons can far, far outweigh the pros. And, you know, we had an instance of nearly taking the wrong investor, and, you know, it was a blessing in disguise that relationship never happened in our first round. It was a large private equity player who, in the heat of kind of 2014-15, decided they wanted to play in the VC space. And we were their first experiment in VC. And so, you know, when we were talking to them, a term, this is a very well-known PE in India, they signed the term sheets, we finished the DD, and just before signing the SHA, they got cold feet. And if I look at the amount of red flags there were in that process and how they approached the investment round or making the investment, I should have pulled out earlier myself and not let it get that far. And the co-investor in that round, and you know, it's all been for the best, now we have IDG, we ruined a bunch of investors, but the co-investor that in that first round was Bloom Ventures, and they're a wonderful investor, I would say they're one of the best investors in India. If not for kind of early stage, the best investor in India, very founder friendly, etc. But you know, the things they were asking us, the private equity player, we had to build out 5-year detailed financial projections as a seed company. And we were getting questions on, had we properly or accurately projected out how much we would spend on mailing, couriering? And had we built enough buffer? And ridiculous, like absolutely ridiculous asks. And I can see back, had that investment gone through, I don't know if the company would have progressed in the same manner that it would have, because the risk appetite and the vision and just the way of operating and values of that investor were so fundamentally misaligned to our stage of company, the company itself, and our other co-investors that we would have been taken so off track. And I think we saw so many companies in 2015 have that problem, where both on the investor and entrepreneur side, there was a massive mismatch, and you know, 2016 was a graveyard of startups. And so I think, you know, the pros far outweigh the cons when you have the right matching of investor and entrepreneur and capital and investment. And when that goes wrong, it can be terrible.
Right. I think these are exactly the real life experiences we wanted the panel to share. And glad Akanksha shared that. So one follow-up question from another gentleman from the audience, Robin. So one question I think has got answered right now was, despite having capital requirements, what would make you turn down an investment offer other than shareholding dilution, right? I think she answered that right now.
Great.
And request the audience, when you probably also send the questions, if you can address it to a specific panelist, if it's relevant to a specific panelist, just put their name followed by the question, that would be great as well. And so just to summarize some of the points that they brought was, you know, Sachin was telling that it gives a process and it sort of puts you on a path, and you also have a support system on various functions where you have capital. And Akanksha made the same point. So you want a structured approach to working, and that is something that the investors bring to the table. And Sachin of Niki said, you know, you would be able to invest in, you know, things that matter in the long term, like marketing, invest in product and development, and so on and so forth. So these are pluses of raising capital. So if you ask me, I would say when you know, personally, when I look at starting up, when I started up, you know, my benchmark was how do you compare with the alternative of being employed, right? So you don't have a salary when you start up, and you don't have a boss, a con and a pro, and then the moment you take funding, you have both, right? So yeah, that's how I see that as well. But if you have exit as a goal in life, obviously, investors help you sort of prepare your company, build value in the company, and also prepare you for exits. But if you're looking at running a lifestyle business, obviously you don't need to get in financial partners, and you can run it on your own without taking in capital. So, coming back to a few more questions, while the audience probably will send a few questions. So, one of the questions is, So how did sort of post-funding experience with some of the your existing investors be? How have they, for example, Ratan Tata in your case, was he accessible given his, obviously he's got like several other things to handle, etc. Was he accessible? Were you able to sort of take his time out, etc., etc.? And also probably also SAP Ventures. So how are they as a fund, being a corporate fund, not a financial investor, how different are they from?
Sure. So, I think every investor has a different, skill set and that he brings on the table. And from an entrepreneur perspective as well, it's very important to set the expectation upfront as well in terms of what you're looking for. And you should be clear about whether or not this is something that you get from the respective investor. So, for example, engaging with Mr. Tata, you'll always have to be very crisp. In terms of what you want. With Ronnie, for example, you have to be very crystal clear in terms of any discussions that you have with Ronnie. Will always be very, very crisp 5-minute discussion, and within that 5 minutes, you come to a conclusion. With SAP, for example, the interactions are very different. They are not a traditional financial investor, and therefore the money that they bring along is for the long term. And they don't look at returns instantaneously. Some of the things that they can help us, which we sort of wanted at least in the early stages, was validating our product roadmap, helping us recruit or at least validate some of the early employees that we were looking to recruit. They helped us tremendously when we were looking for mentors from for tech for. While we're trying to build an organization, we're looking for a mentor for HR, and so on and so forth. So different kind of investors bring different skill sets to the table, and depending on which stage you are in, you should make that choice very, very conscious.
Simply, I will say, it's like. We see them as our strategic partners. The more we share with them, more our day-to-day processes and challenges which we are facing, whether it's cash flow or something, they are becoming more like a good partner for us. And I would say the relationship-wise, really, they are becoming, more like a joint, they are giving us ideas, plus their networks, right, which is quite wide. So it is helping us a lot in terms of having them on board and their current networks. So we feel that more as a business or as a company, if you take your investor as your partner, share your challenges as well as your ups, I would say you will more benefit out of it.
So the next question is, how did you shortlist some of these investors that you reached out to? So you said SAP was a inbound request, and then you were part of the accelerator program. Ratan Tata, you just wrote to him as part of reaching out to multiple investors. So how did you research this one, and probably in your case as well? Subsequently, you took investment from Saha and IDG. So how did you sort of end up researching? Did you have these specific names in mind? What was the long list? How did you sort of filter it? How did you sort of prioritize where would you spend time and whom do you sort of seek capital from? Because you also wanted to be very careful and choosy on whom to take capital from. How did you run that process?
So the first time, I don't think you cut anybody out and you talk to everyone, hence us talking to a private equity player. I think the second time we were far more restrictive, selective. And so we had Bloom helping us introduce us to the right types of fund that made sense for our business. Plus, one thing that I did was I talked to a lot of their portfolio companies. So as much as the VC was vetting me and was vetting m.Paani, I was understanding how they are as an investor. And we did speak to their portfolio companies and say, okay, what kind of interactions do you have? What is the type of relationship you have? We did research on, were there any kind of stories out there of things fundamentally going wrong? Was there, for example, any track record of like firing senior people on a repetitive basis, especially? You know, is this fundamentally an investment partner that is a partner in that business and growing that business together with the team and the leaders? Or what is, if there are any negative stories out there, let's find out what those negative stories are. And so I think because of that, we've ended up with, you know, a really strong set of investors that share the same values as us. And so, you know, IDG is a wonderful investor, Bloom, we have Saha, and then we have three angel investors. Our angel investors really, you know, one of them has become a client of ours now as well. But are far very supportive investors and constantly thinking through how we can take the business to the next level.
Did you use any tools? Did you have a long list? And then this is the diligence after you sort of have a handful of probably interested investors. But how did you narrow to?
I mean, I used Trello to stay organized, but I would say one thing I did between the first round is build relationships. So you never stop fundraising, and so even for us, I think it's not really this one-time exercise you go through. You build relationships with people, and you know, even from a person-to-person level, you figure out the people you like talking to and you tend to have good conversations with and get excited about the work they're doing and they get excited about the work you're doing. So when it comes to your second round, especially, or your next business, it's a very natural fit. You kind of know who to talk to and who you're going to be able to work with.
So this question was from Barda, from Venture Intelligence, the data provider. One of the tools they also have is investor directory, which is something that's handy for entrepreneurs. You can select by sort of stage, sector, and sort of shortlist, narrow down the large list of funds that are available, along with contacts. So I think that's a handy tool probably for the entrepreneurs.
All right. Yeah. Before we actually started, I will say almost a year back, I was not aware, what home to approach, what size to approach, whether the ticket size of this VC is this much and this P this much is not totally not aware. So almost 1 year before we started, I was with KPMG and I met my co-founders. I said, if somebody is ready to fund, maybe we will start off, right? So that was the thought process. And pretty much from almost, we would have sent email to maybe more than 100 VCs of these, right? Just from the list, take the list and just send it out. Some responses, but slowly, sort of realized that, the ticket sizes which we are looking at, and if it's a large global PE or a fund which just comes before an IPO, or whether it is a growth stage or mid stage, they will not really look at maybe very initial stages, right? So this really came with learning that what is the ticket size of that particular VC or PE, right? Because if you are raising a 5 crore and if you are looking at a PE or a VC which has a minimum ticket size of say 25 crore, then most probably it's very difficult for that to get their attention. Second, many of the, you will see that, many VCs and PEs, their sectors are very clearly defined,
right?
Whether they are doing in AI, cloud, or, if somebody has, as a history, not done an infra, it's very unlikely. I will not rule out, but still, it may be very unlikely. So, some of these are the learnings we are seeing now, as we are again now doing another second round. So, ideally, we know that who will be our target VCs of these, right? But initially, we literally didn't have any kind of experience. So, it was just very random messages.
Great. A couple of last questions from my side, and then probably we can open up for even more questions offline as well. So, one quick five question. So, how many investors have you pitched to so far?
If you take off the emails, just meetings may be 4 or 5.
4 or 5. And email, you said 4 or 5. And so how many entrepreneurs pitched you on a regular basis?
Maybe over the last year, I must have heard about 200 pitches. I probably invested in about 5 of them.
There you go.
French.
Great.
And any strange meeting that you had, strange experience with pitching meetings for any of you? Maybe you can go without names, but if you can share the experience.
Ideally, when we were meeting, some of the VC firms, at least one of the meetings didn't go well. I don't know the name, but the partner was not at all interested. I guess in a one-hour meeting, maybe it was like just hardly 5 minutes or maybe 10 minutes in the room. Rest of the time, every minute, going in, going out on the phone. When we are as entrepreneurs also looking at, say, somebody as an investor, looking at, somebody who can be a partner in your journey, right? Not just ask for, at least we were not comfortable. Of course, that didn't go ahead. But that is just one of the things that we were comfortable initially.
Unfortunately, I wouldn't call it a strange meeting. Probably that's the most common type of meeting that you get. As an entrepreneur, when I used to fundraise as well. So that is why probably selecting the right VC to sort of pitch to is very important, so that you don't end up with each other.
So I had a subset of VCs ask me if I have or have plans to get a male co-founder. And that was a way to get them off my list immediately. I also had some number of cases of very frankly inappropriate conduct. So VCs or their members within their team asking for meetings at Saturday at 9 p.m. Again, those did not make the list.
So one question from the audience, this is Abhyakta who was asking this question. How did you deal with failures, if any? And how difficult is it to stay focused and motivated?
As an entrepreneur, you deal with failures more often than successes. In the last 3 years of our journey with Niki, we've seen a lot of failures. We've seen a lot of instances where the morale of the team was really, really down because of something that happened, and it could be a macro event such as a big player who started competing in the same space, or it could be even a micro event such as an employee who was a real crucial resource. His parents sort of retired, and he had to leave the family. And then it could also be something where a short deal that you were with a potential client, it just fell through at the last moment. So these things happen very, very frequently. I think what we've realized is that the best thing to do is just keep your heads down and continue to focus on the startup that you're building. Just have the original goal that you started with, think of the same thing and keep moving on.
Very shortly, I would say failures are part of your journey. So I guess anytime, to have your plan B ready, right? As an entrepreneur, failures, what level, and so that of course was there when we started off. So I'll just say, failures are part of your journey. If you fear failing, you'll stop winning. It's a very, competition is there. So failure shouldn't be on your head. That's what at least we feel, and as a team, we are getting our regular team support, so there will be various failures. But we have to face it, very positively.
Any questions from the audience if you want to probably raise and ask as well, we can do that. So one more question from Agnes. This is addressed to Vega. Subhu, what is the trend of VCs looking at investing in traditional businesses like retail? What are the trend of VCs investing in traditional businesses like retail? Like not technology,
offline retail business. Okay, so my thinking would be, you know, in any investment that we make, we look at what is the defensibility of this business, right? Apart from obviously the economic viability, the long runway it has, and the executive capability of the founders. So what we think as technology investors, so I run a fund, Astarc, which focuses only on technology investments. The reason we do that is that we believe technology is some sort of business, right? It's not easy for someone else to build equivalent technology, at least in the time frame by which you can sort of capture the market. So if you can answer the question of defensibility, I think a lot of investors would be interested in funding a venture. Right, so that would probably.
I think you said it. I mean, I think there is nothing like a traditional business now, I think. And every business has got impacted with, you know, what's going on around the technology space as well as the other, you know, developments that are happening on the economic side as well. So if a business is not taking advantage of this, then probably it's not worth investing in.
So one question to all of the panelists is, what could be one change that you want to see in the entrepreneurial ecosystem that you think would be a, you know, big wish if you had, you know, tomorrow that can be fulfilled? Each of you can probably take a shot at it.
I think I personally feel that the ecosystem, the startup ecosystem in India, they typically follow the West, and I think most of the entrepreneurs, most of the engineers who power the Valley ecosystem are Indians who leave from here and they sort of start work there or start a company there, and we typically tend to hear their success stories based in India. I think we fundamentally, I believe that in our team, actually, we believe that this is something that does not have necessarily have to be with that, and we thought that it'd be easier to start a product-based company out of India. Yeah, I think even when we started pitching our product to different companies, they were not willing to accept this. They were very, very resistant. But the moment Facebook, for example, came to the bot space, it suddenly became out and everyone wanted to build a bot. And they stopped us. So we realized that there's a lot of trickle-down effect happening because people, not just visitors, but also I think startup founders, they follow the West. I think we can be innovators. Based on again, I think we should definitely strike.
Follow the West.
Yeah.
I think I would love to see clients, especially if you're in B2B businesses, have greater risk and innovation appetite. A lot of us are trying to work with, you know, companies and businesses and change the way things are done with new technologies. If someone, don't wait for someone else to do it to give you the confidence to experiment. And have more risk appetite with respect to the idea, have more risk appetite with respect to working with smaller and new teams. They're going to be far more dedicated in making sure we ensure it's a success. And also, I do think the willingness to pay. I think in India, willingness to pay and pay on time, because if we're going to have a healthy startup ecosystem, there has to be value extracted for every player in that value chain. And so if you are being provided a service or a product, that ecosystem only gets nurtured when small businesses can grow as well and startups can grow as well. And it's not competition. I think India is a very big country and everyone can succeed together.
One change I would say, see, when somebody is working in an entrepreneurial ecosystem, the kind of experience which he or she gets is very different and quite holistic. I would say if somebody is going back from, say, startups to a corporate, right? So the corporates need to see that experience in a more valuable way, which I see is a challenge right now. Like, unlike if you say in Silicon Valley and other places, the experience of startup and really people are able to take that risk. In India, if you see, though there are a lot of accelerators and everything is coming up, but again, if somebody, I mean, we know there are a lot of failures, right? So if somebody is going back to the corporate, then the corporate ecosystem should really take it very positively, and that experience is much more valuable. That's what I feel.
Two things from my perspective on the investment side. One is originality of ideas. I think that is an area where I believe that we can do a whole lot, and that can actually be quite tuned to the needs that we have in this country. Because of the 200 that I said, you know, quite a bunch of them would be like, you know, I will Uberize this business, I will Uberize that business. So it is not the original idea which can be defensible, right? That is the first thing that I would like to see. The second is ability to execute. I think, you know, more than the idea itself, a second grade idea can actually become a first grade success just with the sheer quality of execution. So I don't see that rigor in many of the startups that come in front of me. You know, that is the area where I guess there's a lot of work to be done.
To summarize, probably we have, you know, we're not copying from the West as one big change. From Akanksha, we had risk appetite from enterprise customers, both in sort of engaging early, engaging with startups, paying on time, paying right amounts, etc. Very important. And you have, you know, startup failures or these talent that sort of work in startups and then go back to corporates, treat them with value, treat them because they've come with a lot of learnings. And you know, Subbu sort of echoing what Sachin said also, which is originality of the idea, and on top of it, execution, the ability to execute. Maybe I'll add one to that list. Number of cash exits that can be provided in India, sort of the B2B or large enterprise customers who can go out and sort of buy companies, and probably even the larger startup unicorns buy other companies by paying cash, right? So not talking about stock swap, sort of, you know, one friendly investor bailing the other out, but real cash exits in good volumes. So that's another wish that I have for the ecosystem. Yeah, so there's one, yeah, a couple of questions if you can.
Very good afternoon. My question is to Mr. Ramasubramanian, sir. Sir, as you rightly said, there's a lack of, innovation, and the same ideas are floating around in the VC space, ideas, and same ideas. So basically my question is that even after that, people are getting funded. So many companies with the same ideas, if you take the example of Bangalore City, there's so many startup ideas. If I, no offense to everyone who is in the same space, like bike renting, furniture and furniture on rent. There's so many startups, 10 to 15 startups I've seen in the last 6 to 12 months. They're getting funding. So basically if you see from outside, we see that what's happening across the industry. They are not making money, they're losing the money. Okay, they are burning, their burning is still as high as crore per month. But still they are getting funding at a higher valuation. So we, we are not able to understand that how this industry is working like.
What's your question?
So the question is that why people are funding these sort of companies?
People are funding.
Why people are funding these companies?
So I think one is could be, you know, lack of shared intelligence, you know, at that level, because quite a bit of things are unorganized or less organized, right? As you go higher up the chain, you know, there's a lot of visibility of what's happening. But at the angel level, I guess there is a lot of, you know, lack of transparency and the deals that are happening in other parts of the country. And this is a very large ecosystem we are talking about. So it's quite natural that some similar ideas get funded, right? That is quite possible. But I think there is companies like Venture Intelligence which try to provide some data so you can take some due diligence before you make a call on whether you invest or not. The second thing would be the geography, you know. Given the size of the country, you know, an idea which can grow to a certain size and stabilize there, it can be in one part of the country, in one state or in one region, it can still become a very large business. So I don't see any problem with that as long as it is not overlapping, you know, two, three ideas in the same space, in the same geography. So you can still do that, and going back to what Hari said, at that point, if there is a bio opportunity, when there is a dominant player who is acquiring this and making it a much larger thing, that's good for everybody in the ecosystem.
Sure, maybe I'll add to that. See, I think some of the spaces that you mentioned, ride sharing, furniture, etc., these are like huge spaces, right? There can be multiple players that can exist. Probably at least 4-5 large companies that can be built in India. And the second, probably the reason could be that, you know, out of probably 30-40 companies, you don't know which is the company or which is the team that's going to really execute it successfully, right? So there are multiple investors who take a bet on different teams, hoping that that is the team that could execute, because it's very difficult to sort of judge the execution ability of a team at an early stage, right? You will only sort of know it in hindsight. Probably that is another reason, I think. But I think some of the spaces that you mentioned are so large that they could have multiple players, and that could be a possible reason. Apart from, obviously, you can have geographic specific, some leaders who could consolidate it.
Panelists, so one of the best things about the venture business, which Hari has chosen to join, is he gets to hang out with so many entrepreneurs, right? So there's actually a bright side to the dark side. Thank you so much, and we invite you for a photo op. As I describe the next panel,
it was a fun panel. Thank you all of you, panelists.
So we're going to have 3 to 4 VCs on the following panel. It's a VC. This is entrepreneur panel, and that's a dark side panel. So, unless they can grow otherwise. So they're going to have 2 VCs who float down from Bangalore. So you can really feel for them getting to the airport and all that. So one VC on the next panel is floating from Tokyo. I think better than Bangalore, easier than Bangalore. And one from very old Mumbai, right? So we're going to have the final networking break now. So please do grab time with these entrepreneurs.